Greetings and welcome to the DVD edition of The Taboo of Sovereignty, Money, Love, and Power. This talk was recorded in Vancouver to a capacity audience in May 2004. This inspirational and motivational talk will empower you with information on individual and national sovereignty, helping us to restore our rights and freedoms. As H.G. Wells once said, human history becomes more and more a race between education and catastrophe. This powerful introduction to the work and vision of Johnny Liberty gives us a clear map to learn the seven aspects of sovereignty. The four internal, the mental, the emotional, the spiritual, and the physical, and the three external, the legal, the political, and the economic. How many do you control? This talk is a poignant reminder of how we need to take personal accountability, seeking to become more response able. William Hazlitt reminds us that the love of liberty is the love of others, and the love of power is the love of ourselves. And on that note, enjoy this inspirational and electrifying presentation. And now introducing Mr. Johnny Liberty.
I haven't been in Vancouver, British Columbia in almost 10 years. This is the first presentation that I've given in this city and in this part of Canada. So I'm very thankful, I'm very grateful to Aza and the crew for inviting me to come up. We just happened to meet about a year ago. You know how networking is, how people connect. One person gets to meet someone and you have some kind of resonance, and then you meet someone else and then opportunities show up. We underestimate the power of networking. You know, networking oftentimes has gotten a bad rap because sometimes we just associate it with multi-level marketing and things like that, but networking itself is the art of being able to create relationships, to be able to find connections, natural connections, not forced connections, but connections that are natural. So when I got started in a lot of my actual teaching work, I started in the area of networking almost 35 years ago. When I was in college, I was born and raised in the States, in Michigan, and after I read the Whole Earth Catalog, how many of you were around or remember the first edition of the Whole Earth Catalog? Now this was a cultural transition point between what was then traditional mainstream culture and the alternative cultures that were being born. The Whole Earth Catalog was a toolbox. It was subtitled Access to Tools. It was a directory of every kind of alternative tool that you couldn't find anywhere else. And when I read that book and I got inspired by it and I just went, aha, I get it. Here I am, I'm 19 years old. What do I know, right? Born and raised, taught and trained in college, learning all this stuff, but there's this whole other world over here that I had no knowledge of whatsoever. And so I realized at that moment that this tool was going to shape an entire culture, that actually networking is very powerful when you use it in the right way, when you use it in an appropriate way. And then way back then, of course, we didn't have the types of technologies that we have today. So networking came first. That was my first real inspiration. And so I wrote my first book in 1983 called The Power and Significance of Communications Networking. Because even then, we had just started to enter into the computer age where computers were accessible to the average Joe, where you could buy a computer. I mean, they were clunky, but I was thrilled to death to get my first Macintosh, you know, back then, and McWrite and McPaint, you know, fabulous, it was exciting. And you look back now, in hindsight, of course, and then the younger people and the new generations are being raised now, and they just assume, well, computers have been with us forever, right? CDs and DVDs and video and equipment and all this stuff is just commonplace, like it's always been here. But some of us that are a little older have a little longer view of things. And that's one of the benefits of age, is you get a perspective on how much change has happened in the course of a lifetime. And so back then, as today, I've brought all that work forward into the work I'm doing with ICR today. And although I'm somewhat famous or somewhat infamous, you could say, for my sovereignty education and my sovereignty work under the banner of Johnny Liberty, which is a pen name. Actually, where my heart of hearts lies is in building a global resource center, networking center, resource center, media center, news service, to be able to inform people at a scale of media we have available today that was not available when the Whole Earth Catalog came out 35 years ago. It was just a book, you know, and a few people bought it. It was, you know, a few hundred thousand copies maybe. But today we have communications technologies and the capability to instantaneously communicate worldwide. But we have a few problems that we've inherited over the last 200 or 300 years, which is we don't have control over our lives. We don't have control over our basic political, economic, and legal systems. We don't have control over the ideas that are being foisted at us through the media. Although we have all these wonderful tools available now, we've lost control of some very foundational things that we must reclaim to live a successful life, I believe. To truly be free and to live a successful life, we have to reclaim some of what we've lost as technology has come barging into our lives and not always been positive in its impact to the environment, to human society, to other things. So everything's up for reevaluation. Tonight, the topic is about taboo, because I'm beginning to enter into the domain of taboo. Now, you may have a gut feeling about what taboo is. What is taboo? Well, something that's forbidden, something you don't talk about, something you don't even acknowledge as any reality. And so I'm going to enter into some domains of taboo tonight, and I welcome you to open your minds. I welcome you to, just for this evening, if it's possible, to set aside all of your preconceptions. Just imagine that possibly the whole universe is being created right in this moment. And there never was a Big Bang Theory, and we weren't born 70 years ago, and my name is not John Van Hove, and a lot of things that we assume to be so may very well be just beliefs, or a chosen perception, or viewpoint, or point of view. And whether it's political or whether it's personal, whether it's spiritual or religious, it is just a point of view. And if you look real carefully at human society and 7 billion people that we have on the planet, would you not acknowledge that we have 7 billion points of view, at least? Do you have any two people that are identical? Do you have any two human beings that are identical in experience, in look, in race, in creed, in belief, in color, in upbringing, in locality? I don't think so. We even dress differently, and, you know, all that. So there are 7 billion approaching individuals on the planet, each one with a particular viewpoint that is honestly not shared with anyone else, totally. Now, once in a while, we bump into each other along the way, and we share viewpoints, or we share common beliefs, we share common perspectives. But everyone is unique. And so there is no boilerplate, cookie cutter formula for success or for anything that I'm about to say. All I'm asking you to do is open your minds to the possibility that your viewpoint and my viewpoints could actually converge this evening, and we can learn something and expand our own consciousness. Consciousness. What is consciousness? We don't really use the word very much. I didn't even include it in the title tonight. But consciousness, what is that? That's when you look in the mirror in the morning and you see yourself. Who are you? What is that? What are you seeing? Who is seeing what you believe yourself to be? What is that self-reflective part of you, that part that can reflect upon, actually observe you looking in the mirror? Consciousness. Every one of us has consciousness of some kind or other, and it's shaped by our upbringing and our viewpoints and our beliefs and our education and the media and all of the information and the stimulus response that we bring into our own environment, to our own lives. In some ways, it shapes us until we take charge of the shaping, until we decide to start living deliberately and choosing deliberately to start shaping our own beliefs, at least re-examining them first, and then deciding, yes, I do believe that, instead of just accepting what others believe without question. That's the domain of taboo. When you accept other people's beliefs, whether it's societal or political or the media or because it's, you know, published or because, and you don't really make it your own by reflecting upon its relevance to your life, then it takes up space in our consciousness that otherwise could be utilized for our own co-creation, our own creative, you know, something. Everybody has come here, all 7 billion people, with a purpose, some kind of purpose. And who decides what that purpose is? Is it for me to decide what your purpose is? Is it for the government to decide? Or is it for the bankers to decide? Is it for teachers, parents even? Parents do decide to a great degree, up to a certain point, shape their children's viewpoints on the world. When do we step beyond that and go, you know, mom and dad were right about a few things, but these other things here really aren't mine. And I am going to shift and change into something that's more accommodating to what I believe to be true. That's the maturation process, the growth process, the learning process, all of that. So taboos have to be approached from a very open mind, because if your mind is closed, well, you know, nothing can get in there. There's no place for anything to move or shift or change. And that's okay. A lot of people are very content, content to live that way, sometimes for most of or all of their lives. But then again, if you don't actually fulfill the purpose you came here to do and you don't even know what your purpose is, what kind of life is that? And so these are all reflections. These are all just questions. They're not answers. They're just questions. This is an inquiry tonight about the taboos of sovereignty, which is a term that's being thrown around a lot these days. It's a very old, endearing term. It has very different meaning and application based on your viewpoint and on what you believe or know sovereignty to be. So I'm going to explode and expand upon your notion of sovereignty this evening. And then money, taboo of money. Why do I say money is a taboo? What's taboo about it? You know, you either got it or you don't have it. You know, I like money. Everybody likes money, right? You like to have it because you can spend it and buy things and do all this stuff. But if we really, really examined it, what is money? Who makes it? Who controls it? And what kind of society have we created out of our love, our addiction to money? What kind of world are we creating? So let's just step back and take a re-examination of money and what it really is, because it ain't what you believe, more than likely. Money is a fascinating subject. And I would say of probably all the taboos, money is probably the most difficult one to actually address. We could get into religious and politics and everything else here, and we have a good, lively discussion, but when you start talking about money, or you start getting into the psychology of money, or how much we are addicted to certain patterns and beliefs about money that shape our behaviors on a daily basis, we start triggering. You start getting triggered. So we're not going to have a big group gestalt therapy session here tonight, so we're not going to go that deeply into money and, you know, start throwing things at each other. Okay, so don't worry. It's okay. Just fasten your seatbelts. Sovereignty, money, love. Why is love taboo? Everybody loves love, right? Well, what is it? What is the stuff that love is, and why are we so screwed up about it? How can we have so many misconceptions and so many things that are confused about it? And what is it? Where does it arise from? And I think I love you, but maybe it's just biochemistry. I don't know. What is it? Let's take a good look at it. And then last but not least is power. Power.
Power.
Who has it? Anybody in this room have any power? Power. Do you have power? Who has power? Any power? Power. Power. Hey, to raise your hand, it takes power. It takes power to raise your hand. It takes power to come here this evening and make a decision. It takes power to get up in the morning and go to work and do the thing you love to do. It takes power to shape your world and your reality to one that works for you, to shape your physical, your mental, your emotional, your spiritual realities, and your political, economic, and legal realities. We've got a lot of misconceptions running about power. We've got a lot of programming running around power. Like, as if power is out there somewhere.
Well, I ain't got it. Somebody must have it. I don't feel powerful. I feel like just a schmuck, you know. Everything happens to me. I'm just a victim, you know. Nothing. I can't do anything. You know, I do what I'm told. Just follow orders, stand in line. Some people are very content with that point of view. I'm not very content with that point of view. Because I don't believe I'm a victim. I don't believe I'm a victim of my world, my reality. No matter how horrible it might look out there, I'm not a victim of it. I don't want to be victimized by it anymore than I want to be terrorized by it. I want to be able to stand in my power and then choose my fears, you know, and admit it if I am. Be honest with myself. Power is tricky, very tricky business. So we're going to address all of those. And I'm going to begin with sovereignty because that's the piece that I've been looking at and examining for the last 12 years and actually tooling it into a fine art, an art of living, a way of living that very few people have yet emulated, but that I have and fully embodied it to a degree most people aren't still willing to take or to risk, but I have, and I am empowered by it, by having tackled that and grappled that taboo. So what is sovereignty? What do we know sovereignty to be? Well, we hear about it in reference to indigenous people. Indigenous people have sovereignty, right? We all have heard that, haven't we? Government, nations have sovereignty, right? Or they don't. You know, they have sovereignty. Canada is a sovereign nation, is it not? America, US, all nations are purportedly sovereign, they're supposedly sovereign. In other words, they have independent governments, right? You have a government here and it's sovereign from the government in the US, right? But there's also the notion of sovereignty from the individual point of view. If we're 7 billion people on the planet, then sovereignty must have something to do with people. Would it not? Wouldn't sovereignty, if governments are sovereign, and governments are comprised of who? People? Then wouldn't sovereignty also rest with people as well? In fact, not only rest with people, that sovereignty originates with people. It's not governments that have sovereignty over people. It's people who have sovereignty over government. In truth, take a good look at that one in the mirror. Because it seems to me that everything out there is upside down, as far as I can tell. Because it looks like to me, when I walk out there and I see authorities here and police over here and governments over here, they seem to think that they have authority over me in every aspect of my life, controlled to the last, down to the last fingernail and how long it should be. I'm sure there's a law about it somewhere. You know, you got to trim your fingernails to a certain level and point, you know, to be socially, politically acceptable out there. You know, law has gotten ridiculous. It's gotten absurd, the point we are regulated. How much regulations and laws and rules and social norms and everything else. I mean, we're so damn polite. So in my view of sovereignty, sovereignty originates with the individual, which would be me, would it not? It's me, you. So there is such a thing as individual sovereignty. And if you were the only person on the planet, for example, and there wasn't anything but you, then you would have to take total charge and total responsibility for your existence. You'd have to be responsible for everything that you needed to live, to survive, to thrive, to eat, to da-da-da-da-da. And in modern times, we've slipped away from that notion that I'm responsible for myself. That we've slipped away from that idea that I actually is where I'm where power begins. I'm the power. I'm the source of sovereignty. And it's through my actions or inactions. It's through my seeing or not seeing. It's through my blindness or my insight that my life evolves and emerges into something that either works or isn't worked. So if ultimately, if I'm a victim, then who created the victim? Did I make you a victim? Yeah, you did. You're the victim. You're doing it to me, aren't you? You know, point the finger. But really, it's just avoiding responsibility for creating something, even if it's victimization. So, but it could also be empowerment, too.
So my foundational break the taboo of sovereignty is that you are the source of power and authority over your life. I'm not saying you have authority over other people. I'm not saying you should take your power and wield a big club and start clubbing other people with it. Oh, human history, you go back and you can see that's been done and is being done today. It's sort of pretty commonplace. You look at all of human history, I would say we're probably not more about than a stone's throw away from the cave in terms of our mentality in global world affairs. Just whatever guy has a bigger club, you know, and he beats the other guy. I mean, duh. You get it, right? Doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that one out, right? But still, in all that, and why do I address sovereignty? Because I see sovereignty as a key to evolution, to growth, to learning, to exploding beyond this old paradigm of clubbing each other, and all the stuff that we're doing is because we keep avoiding our own responsibility for being our own authorities and having our own power. And we are doing it on a large scale. Anybody like the government or love the government? What's going on in Canada or US today? I mean, you love it? I mean, if you had a choice, would you change it? You'd make changes, you'd improve it, right? I don't know why I'm saying if. I'm saying, why aren't we changing it, is what I'm asking. Why aren't we changing it? What is it in our beliefs that's stopping us from believing that we have the power to change the governments? What stops us? What taboo is in our mind that says, I don't can't do anything, can't fight City Hall, you know, I mean, it's always been this way, politicians are corrupt, they're always gonna rob us, you know, just gotta put up with it, right? Just put up with it, tolerate it. That's what we're told, that's what we're taught. I say no. I say we really can change it, not just individually, but collectively too. We could be more effective if a lot of people decided to put their sovereignty together and actually say no to things they don't like that are going on. And I will assure you, things will change. They always have. Throughout the course of human history, it's been a small group of people that have created the revolutions or created the major shifts. And usually it started with one individual who's just been really stubborn. Stubborn behind a principle, stubborn behind something that they know to be true. You know, and even put up with persecution, you know. The earth is round, right? Flat or round, what is it? All the flat earth people on this side of the room, all the round earthy people on this side of the room, right? It took amazing courage for Galileo to stand up to charges of heresy and finally being burned at the stake because he believed the earth was round. I mean, you know. Terrible. So we look back at it now, we laugh, but we go, but in hindsight, we know how ridiculous that is. How ridiculous that is. How absolutely ridiculous. You could be persecuted for something like that. But look around today at how people are being persecuted because they believe they're sovereign, because they have the power to change things, and because they have a cure for cancer that, you know, corporate America doesn't want you to know about. You know, renewable power, all the things that are innovations which we have at our fingertips right now. Every innovation that we have in the world is being suppressed right now by an old paradigm structure that's living in the Stone Age, in the mind of a Stone Age mentality with a big club. How is it going to change unless or until you and I decide to change it? Because you and I get together individually. First, we have to reclaim our own power. We can't just say, well, you know, let her do it. You do it, you're better. They point their finger at me and say, Johnny, you do it. You just do it for all of us. Please, you know, tell me how it comes out. I said, it ain't going to come out very well if I have to do it all by myself. At least for everybody. So, no more finger pointing, you know. You know what they say about the finger out there and three back, right? It's time to just start pointing the finger right here and go, you know, really, if I want to change, it's right here. Start small. You don't have to take on the world to start with. Just start small. Just start re-examining your life and start seeing the things that aren't working in your life and take the power, make the decision to change things and make your life better. In all of the aspects of sovereignty, as I teach them now, it's not just about not paying your taxes, folks. That's what a lot of people think sovereignty is today.
Well, if I just don't have to pay my taxes, then I'm sovereign, right? Just give me the legal paperwork and that's all I need to do, right? Get the government out of my business, you know? We don't like them.
Well, that's an aspect. I mean, that can be an aspect. But what's the attitude there? There's many, many more aspects to sovereignty that have to be embodied first. And quite honestly, before you really can step into power in the world out there, the external world, you got to step into power in the internal world. Whatever that is for you. So the seven aspects of sovereignty, there's four internal and three external. The first one is physical sovereignty. Are we not in a body? Each one of us in an individual body, or what appears to be an individual body, that we must take care of. And if we don't, it's pretty hard to get around. It's pretty hard to make a great contribution to world society if we can't take care of our own vehicle. So we have to have our physical sovereignty. We've got to attend to our health and wellness. That's foundational. And we have the capacity to do that. There's many, many, many alternative paradigms for health and healing. There are very few integrative ones. And I mean ones that integrate all of the alternative and the mainstream things into a singular healing process. I just came from a clinic in Reno, Nevada. Fabulous. Sierra Integrative Medical Clinic. Third generation radical homeopathic therapy. Curing people of chronic illnesses and diseases they've had all of their lives in a matter of a few weeks or a few months, because they have comprehensive diagnostics, the most comprehensive I've ever seen. I don't see any diagnostics going on out there at all. They test you for the things that they can prescribe drugs for. They don't test you to see how healthy you are and where your body's immune system is not working, so they can build your immune system to fight the disease and the pathogens and the chemicals and the allergies and the disease and the bacteria and the viruses and the vaccinations and everything else that you put in your body and all the chemical sensitivities and everything else that's affecting your health in one big soup that you can't sort out and your doctors can't even help you sort out because they're not even trained to sort it out. There are alternative paradigms for everything. But you have to seek them out. You have to desire them. You have to want to look. You want to live. You want to live enough to go seek them out. Don't just accept the prognosis from the doctor that you have 5 weeks to live and it's terminal. I don't accept that. There are alternatives. So physical sovereignty, health and wellness is foundational. One aspect of sovereignty. The second aspect of sovereignty is emotional. And this is the area in my hindsight, wisdom, in reflection upon looking at people and knowing people intimately, is that it's in the emotional realm where we fall and we stumble and we collapse. We're not very good at handling emotional fear, angers, joys, ecstasies, pains, pleasures. We are a society bent on denying and defying our emotions, like we are defying and denying death itself. And thus, we do not allow ourselves, we do not give ourselves permission to even experience our emotions, let alone have healthy ones. So we're running around emotionally crippled. Most human beings are emotionally crippled, have no capacity to feel whatsoever. Now, they get this surge of energy in their body and they call it anger. I'm angry. But they also conceptualize it and dismiss it without really exactly getting to it or allowing themselves, or people around them don't allow them, to express it. Or they don't express it in a healthy way. Or a way that's not going to damage someone else or turn into violence. Violence is the consequence of anger which has no place to go. Anger that nobody wants to acknowledge, anger that nobody wants to be cause for or responsible for. And I would say war is just another organized anger on a state level. That's all. revenge, vengeance. You see it in the good old USA Today. We're gonna have to, we gotta get somebody for 911. We don't care who pays the price, but somebody's gotta pay. That's so inappropriate and so wrong. So we have to take responsibility for our emotional sovereignty, where people stumble in their fear, mostly. Fear becomes much larger than it is. When fear is not expressed or acknowledged, it becomes much larger than it really is. A healthy fear, a good fear, is a good fear to have. If I'm walking down the street and some big mad dog is running after me and chasing me, and suddenly I get alerted to it and it scares me, it pumps your body and your adrenaline to responding to run faster and fast to get away from that dog. So fear is not bad, there's no judgment on it. But to respond accordingly. But not to walk around through life fearing that some dog's gonna chase me and bite me. If I spend my whole life fearing that some dog might attack me my whole life, and there ain't no dogs around, and maybe no dogs even ever bit me, what kind of fear is that? That's an imagined fear, right? Where are people stumbling and falling in all the imagined fears? And wow, let me tell you, the media is the mastermind of imagined fears coming at you at 400 million kilobytes per second, consuming every ounce of your brain power to process. Subconsciously, if not consciously. So we have to face our fears. And if you can simply make this distinction between the real and the imagined fears, most of the fear in your life will dissipate. Be afraid when there's cause to be afraid. You know, if the wolf's at the door, deal with it. Respond accordingly. But if there ain't no wolf at the door, stop imagining that there is. Or that the government's gonna get you. Or if you don't pay your taxes, they're gonna come put you in jail. Or if I don't pay that parking ticket, they're gonna impound my car. Or if every damn thing that I do, you know, somebody's watching over me, and there's all these laws and rules, I don't understand any of them, but I know I gotta obey them, but I don't know what to obey, and you know, is it real or is it not real? We're walking nightmares of fear. And a lot of movies are just bad dreams. And you pay for them. Hey, $7, $8. Give me a bad dream so I can go to sleep. Killing, maiming, torture. Ugh, great. You've heard the expression, garbage in, garbage out. Garbage in, garbage out. So who's going to take the garbage out? Ain't my responsibility, right? Who's going to bring the garbage in? Ain't my responsibility either. Oh, but it is. You bring the garbage in because you decide to. So you're going to produce garbage as a consequence of it. So stop bringing garbage into you, and you won't have so much garbage to put out in the world either. And that's when we come to the third aspect of sovereignty, which is mental. Take charge of your own minds. Take charge of the input. Yeah, some of it, you know, you can't avoid when you're driving on the highway and you see the billboards and, you know, and your TVs and media and papers and all this stuff. But some of it is actually you can choose not to input. Is there anybody here addicted to the newspaper? Got to read the darn thing every morning, right? You buy one, you pick one up, you read it, the headline, shock, adrenaline, fear, maiming, killing, torture, something, right? Garbage in. Evening news, any addicts to the evening news, gotta see what the news anchor's got to say about the war in Iraq tonight. How many people have been beheaded? I mean, ugh. Garbage in. Who gets to decide what goes into your mind? Ultimately, who decides? Who's sovereign? I'm sovereign, which is I decide.
Part of the commitment is.
And I can actually not read the paper or not tune in.
I can't stand it.
In my leadership training program, the little exercise we do, which is part of the commitment, is you have to go on a 30-day media fast. Oh my God, the withdrawals, I can't stand it. Heroin I could get off of, but media, no. No, please, give me my daytime soaps. I gotta have it, I can't live without it. Oh Lord, help us. We're addicted. Claim your mental sovereignty, though. Claim it, that's all. Sovereignty's so easy, folks. It isn't complicated, just claim it. And claim all seven aspects of it. Claim your physical wealth and well-being. Claim your emotional sovereignty. Claim your mental health and well-being by the garbage that comes in and the garbage that goes out. Man, we can clean up the world real quick this way. And we can take market share away from the media moguls that are mind-controlling us and programming us into being subjects of fear and terror. Who are the real terrorists? Who are the real terrorists out there? They smile at you. Hi, I'm the news anchor. This is the evening news. How many people were beheaded today? And they smile. No emotional response whatsoever. Down in the States, I was very shocked. I mean, after 911, you probably got impressions of it too, but it was the first time I ever saw news anchors not know what to say. In the first 12 hours after 911, they were boondoggle. They were stuttering. Well, I don't know what the heck happened here. You know, because nobody's talking in their ear telling them what to say. It was uncontrolled. It was out of control. That was a window in to the media world. Absolute, total control by four or five major corporations, fed by governments all around the world to tell you what to think, how to think, what your impressions are going to be, what's going on in the war here, the war there, what war is important, which one's not. Why all this focus on Iraq? I mean, aren't there other wars going on? Yeah, there's 40 other wars going on in the world you never hear about. Why is that? Oh, they're not important. Well, who decides what's important? So if you really want to be informed, you got to go beyond the evening news, the daily newspaper, and you got to go out, and you can find a lot of informed sources on the internet and international sources. I go to international sources and BBC and, you know, different papers around the world because I can't get any news in the USA. They don't tell you nothing down there. Let me tell you, we are more starved for information in the USA than anywhere in the world. America is not a free country. America is the most controlled, slave country in the world today. The people. And most people don't know that around the world. Yeah, we were driving around in SUVs and homes and all that kind of stuff, but let me tell you, we're terrorized down there by our own government and by the media. And it's all really, really majorly shift since 911. Major shift. In fact, if I was to say what there was 911 for America, it was a coup d'etat. It was a coup d'etat of the democracy, which America is not, by the way, it's a republic, but anyway, it was founded as a republic, became a democracy, and then became a military dictatorship, basically, under national security. National security state was imposed after 911. Absolute ironclad control. And even Congress is scared to speak up. So, anyway, I don't mean to be the bearer of bad news, but it's also the bearer of good news in the sense that you may not have heard that, or you may not know that. And I'm here as a harbinger. I may be the last free American who is actually an American citizen. I may be one of the very few last true Americans because they've robbed everything. They've even taken our citizenship from us. And we've become something other than what we were. Not in principle, because the fire of freedom is alive in America in the hearts of the people. So Mark Twain said it very well, love your country always. Love your government when it deserves it. It may apply here in Canada too. Just a wee bit. So importantly here is the mental sovereignty part. Very, very important. You get to decide what to learn. Yeah, we've all got programming to deal with and indoctrinations we're going to have to weed out. There's nobody, myself included, that hasn't accepted indoctrinations through the course of your education, your schooling, and everything else in your particular field or class. All it means is that our viewpoint has gotten more rigidly identified as a certain thing, and then our minds are closed and we can't see that there's other ways of seeing things. And there just are other ways of seeing things, that's all. So open up a little space in your mind to other ways of seeing things and it can balance out your perspective. So when I look at the news and I want to get good news reporting, I want to get balanced news reporting. I don't want the media to tell me what to think and what to think. I want the media to provide me a balanced view of all the viewpoints involved so I can make up my own mind and decide for myself what can conclude and what actions I might take or what my political stand might be. So there's a lot of work we have to do in the mental sovereignty area. physical, emotional, mental, and then last, on the internal realm, is spiritual sovereignty. Spiritual sovereignty is whatever your divine relationship to God or the Creator or Jesus or whatever religion or whatever spiritual path that you have, every one of those 7 billion people on the planet has their own unique relationship with the divine. Despite organized religion and despite, you know, grouping people together and over-identifying in a lot of cases with one particular way of seeing God and the world and spirituality. And if you really opened up the mind a little bit to seeing things from other viewpoints, you'll see a lot more commonality than differences. There may be language and cultural and historical differences, but that's true of all 7 billion people anyway. So why should it be different in the area of religion or in spirituality? As it is in politics too. People disagree. It's okay. Not a problem. Disagree strongly. That's a free country. If there's no disagreement, I'm concerned. I'm really concerned if people aren't arguing with each other and disagreeing. Where's the freedom there? Where's the freedom to have your own point of view? If everybody's just towing the party line for fear of retribution, what does that say about the kind of world we live in or we're choosing? I am not a victim, and I would propose that none of us are victims. So no matter how horrible the government can be in some ways, they didn't do it to me. There's no finger pointed at them. Because as soon as I point the finger at anything outside of myself, I become blind to my own responsibility in the matter. Government has no authority over you until you consent. Until you have a consent. There has to be consent. And it could be unspoken, or it could be spoken. Most of it's unspoken because it's misinformed. Because we don't know what our rights are. And we don't know where the boundaries lie between a lawful government and an unlawful government. A de jure government and a de facto government. De jure means by rule of law. It means it's consistent. Justice is applied to everybody equally. You know, you don't murder and kill and do different things, and that's all common agreements, common law, common sense. But then there's other domains where there simply is no authority until you've consented or contracted to consent to give up some of your power. And you don't have to in a lot of cases. In fact, in most cases. I would say over 90% of the laws on the books don't apply to you. Because you may not be the person that's defined as a person in that code or in that law where that law applies to you. So don't assume you are just because you're a flesh and blood human being. Don't assume they have jurisdiction or that they have authority just because you're a flesh and blood human being. The law is very distinct, very well defined, and most of it only applies to artificial persons, not to natural persons. And so that's a whole other domain of sovereignty, which we'll get into in a second. But I want to complete with the four internal aspects, physical, mental, emotional, spiritual. Then handle those. And then you can step into the domain of economic sovereignty. That's where that taboo of money comes in. Our capacity to deal with our economic independence and economic interdependence as well. And really go in depth and learn about the nature of money and currency and coin and the central banking system and how does it really work and who really controls this? Do I control this? Anybody in this room control the creation of the Canadian money? Had any input lately? No? God, there's something wrong with this picture. I don't understand, because prior to about 1913, in both the US and Canada, maybe it was 13 or 14, one of those years, gold and silver was the coin of the realm. And it was a privately issued coin, in the sense that it was privately circulated. Everybody had control of the monetary system. So the sovereign, the sovereign individual, had their own economic sovereignty in their pocket. It wasn't controlled by a central bank somewhere that decided that, oh, we'll print paper instead and we'll just kind of assume that it's a fiat, that it's by default, it's money. We'll just call it money. I mean, you can take toilet paper and circulate it and say, well, the banks say that now toilet paper is money. Okay, fine. How many pieces? One, two pieces? How many pieces to get in? One roll to get in here tonight?
unroll. It's really cumbersome to run around with a bunch of toilet paper in your pocket and pay for it, you know? But why is that any more ridiculous than running around with these notes, these things, these paper fictions running around that we call money that nobody looks at and questions? Well, some people do, but most people don't ever question it. It's now money, it's always been money, always will be money. And it works, doesn't it? Everybody's feeling rich and prosperous. No struggle paying the bills every month, right? Right? Not a struggle, right? You got plenty left over for the education for the kids, plenty for all the health care you want. You don't need national health insurance because you got enough money in your own pocket to be able to pay the insurance, well, get the healing you want, not through insurance companies. You don't get any health care through insurance companies that I know of. Not a lot, anyway. You got no choice with insurance companies. That's the trouble with nationalized insurance and government programs and all that, is you don't really get choice on your physical sovereignty level. So it's no more ridiculous in my mind when in the U.S. and by U.S. law, and this is just to contrast that the Federal Reserve notes that we carry around as money is literally defined in law as a corporation note of undetermined value. Wow, what does that mean? Corporation note issued by a private corporation of undetermined value, which means it means what we say it means and when it means it. And if we don't like the value that's assigned to it now, we'll change it. And how do we do that? Well, raising interest rates, money supply, all the things that the central bankers use to manipulate the money system. So they can very easily control your money and your buying habits, your opportunities, your life, and your success through the issuing of and the supply and the demand of this whole game called money. But it's taboo. We can't be talking about this. As soon as you want to start talking about the central banking system, the guys with the big guns and the masks will come in the door and they'll start wanting to, you know, shut you up and say, you know, money, no, no, we can't go there. You're stepping on the sacred toes of the sacred cow, of the taboo, of the central bank, and everybody knows who controls and runs things around here. So, you know, watch your step. Governments are just as scared. They toe the line too. Who controls the governments? Got a clue? Anybody? Who controls government? God, this is a smart group. Very smart. You mean it's not a government of the people, by the people, for the people? What happened to that idea? It's of the government. No, it's of the corporation, by the government, for the global elite. That's what it is. So that's your new mantra. You're free to have a bumper sticker. It's going to be a long one. It'll fit the whole back of the bumper, all right? Of the corporation, by the government, for the global elite. That really is the way that it is. And I can laugh about it. And you can laugh about it, too. But let's re-examine. And let's get some new ground rules in on our economic sovereignty, because that is an essential component here. We got to be able to handle our own money and our own finances and use alternatives as well. Alternative currencies and barters and exchanges and restore the gold and silver standards. I mean, all of these things. We need to create a new monetary system. And it has to be created from the individual up if we want it to work. It's not going to work from the government down. It's not going to work by just changing one currency for another or printing new pretty colored currency that's really nice and it's a collector's item and everything else. But it's not going to have any more inherent value in it. We have to create new monetary systems. Who's going to do it? Government going to do it? Corporations going to do it? Banks going to do it? No, not that I know of. They like things the way they are. That's the status quo. Things are working just fine if you're a large transnational corporation or a central bank or a central government. Things are working just fine. And the rest of you? Things working fine? No. Not as fine as it could be. Room for improvement? Yes. So economic sovereignty has to be really taken seriously. So learning about the nature of money and coin and credit and all these things. There's excellent books about it. I mean, you have them here. We have them in the States, too. But don't just assume that, you know, don't be a slave to money. Don't be run by it. Let money be a tool. And even as we still are using these currencies until we transit into something more sustainable, that's more durable, more lasting, more sovereign, and more free, don't get too hung up on it. Or get hung up on that life is about the pursuit of money. It was about the pursuit of happiness in America, and I think it's about the pursuit of happiness here too, which means that all of your life is working. Isn't that happy? All aspects of your life are working and integrated. That's happiness to me. Pursuit of money, I don't see a lot of happy people that just go after money. And whether it's by legal or illegal means. So money has to be looked at. Economic sovereignty, we must have that. Because the best way to help the poor is not to be one of them. Because if you're struggling with money, if you don't have a sense of prosperity consciousness, we've all been indoctrinated into scarcity around money, all of us. Every one of us, no exceptions. You have plenty of money? Anybody? No, there's a scarce amount of money. There's just about enough to pay the bills every month. And it's designed and engineered that way to keep you slaves to money. Money is a control system. That's what it is today. In truth, it's a control system. Does it control you? Oh, it absolutely does. It decides what time you get up in the morning to go to work. It decides what job you go to because you got to pay the bills. It decides what kind of house or place you're going to live in. It decides what kind of education you're going to have. It decides what kind of health care you're going to have. It decides what you have left over to give to the next generation when you die and pass away. These decisions are being made through a medium that you have very little control over, the creation of it. And therefore, you have given up and have very few options, fewer options, when you're a slave to that system. And so we can free ourselves from that through knowledge and education and through some more careful and compassionate types of investments. Direct investments in direct people and projects that are producing things of value that create true economic wealth. Money is not wealth. That is a lie, an illusion. Money is just a piece of paper that represents an opportunity or a tendency of some kind, a choice perhaps, to be able to invest in, to take that dollar and invest it in something of value that can create more value, not just for you, but for everybody around you. Wealth is the inherent ability you have to create something of value and introduce it into the economy. Money is just a measure, and only one measure, of that value. There are many other measures of that value, as mothers know, who raise children, who don't get paid to do it. A lot of people don't get paid to take care of and love people and do things. Does that mean it's not valuable? There's no value there? Of course there's value there. You'd be a fool not to acknowledge the value in that. But when we value everything in terms of money, we become a slave to a value system as well as a control system. And that is something we have to break through. Claim your own values and principles. Claim what's important to you. Claim what's your priority. You decide what's valuable to you, what you want to invest in, however small or grand your equity might be or your portfolio. Even if it's small, even if you just got a few dollars, you know, you can decide where those few dollars go and make a difference in the whole system. And even convert some of that into real tangible producer income creating activity. And that's where the real wealth building comes from. That's why building your own business, creating your own business and free enterprises is a model for sovereignty. Yeah, a lot of people are employees and they work for other people and they get a paycheck. But you know, before 1913, and I don't know the percentage here, but in the States, 98% of the people in 1913 in the United States worked for themselves. 2% were employees. Today, 2% of the people work for themselves and 98% are employees of corporations. And just big major corporations, faceless and personal, don't give a hoot corporations. So you can see how the co-optation has taken over time with a little perspective, and that the reverse trend, getting back into your own business, sustaining yourself financially and economically, finding the well within you of your own creative talent to be able to create something of value and introduce it, is a matter by which you can claim your economic sovereignty in any medium that you might then exchange. Powerful, powerful stuff. So the next aspect is the legal aspect, which I just touched into for a moment. But the legal aspect of sovereignty is the one whereby we have to become informed and re-educated in terms of our citizenships, and whether it's American or Canadian, whether it's natural person or fictitious persons. In the States, we have an inherent dual citizenship there. We have a state citizenship and the federal citizenship, which is actually a fiction. It's not a real citizenship. In the states, the individuals were sovereigns in the states, and the state constitutions created the citizenship of the American. The American citizen is a state citizen by birth or naturalization. The federal United States citizen is simply a title of nobility granted by the federal government in exchange for benefits like welfare, social security numbers, and all those kind of things that come with the U.S. citizenship. But that's not a lawful American citizen. That's just a piece of property in the eyes of the government. Just like cattle with a little brand on them, you get a social security number with a brand on it, and you can get benefits such as, you know, you get your hay and you get your feed and, you know, a few things so you can eat at the trough, you know, with all the other cattle. Pardon the metaphor, but really. And in Canada, I imagine we have a similar scenario here, as we have in all nations of the world as well, of which most nations of the world have never enjoyed even a fraction of the amount of freedom we still enjoy here today. So we still have the opportunity, because we still have the capacity to even meet here and talk about this, to be able to take charge and reclaim all the aspects of sovereignty. And so understanding our citizenship, the nature of law itself, and studying law several hundred years ago, and I can, again, use the American analogy that most citizens knew enough about the law, they didn't need lawyers. Attorneys are a rather modern phenomenon, as we can look at in the phone book. And you see, like, about that many pages of the phone book are attorneys, probably, in Vancouver. But 200 years ago, there weren't hardly any attorneys. Because under the common laws, attorneys could not represent you. If we had a controversy, it was between you and me. And we'd go into a common law court, and maybe it had a judge, and maybe it didn't. Maybe it had a jury, which was a common law jury. And it's the same here. It's a common law country. All the British Commonwealths are common law countries. You have common law, we have British common law too. That's where our constitution and the whole foundation of the American government was founded, on British common law, with the exception of Louisiana, which was French common law. But all the other states were based on British common law. That's where we base our sovereignty on. That's where we base the entire legal system, was founded upon that. No different here. And it's in those common laws where the people could take care of their controversies internally, basically within their own communities, and not have to have hired third guns to come in there as my attorney and your attorney, with the judge being an attorney. What the heck happened here? Something happened along the way where suddenly attorneys took over the courtrooms. Have you noticed? Anybody notice that there's an attorney on both sides of the controversy, and one on the bench, and one in the legislature making the laws? Anybody notice how attorneys took over the country, and when it happened, or how it happened, or what's the history of it? It's fascinating. If you look at the history of power structures in the world and you see the rules of colonization, well, it's not very effective. That's one of the modern innovations of colonialism, which was they realized, and I think the British were probably the first to catch on to this, which it's very inefficient to go out and try to massacre people and try to conquer them, you know. There's much more efficient ways to do it. The British, being what they are, they're just so efficient, you know. They love efficiencies, you know. They love it, yes. They found that the best way to occupy a nation was legally, economically, and politically. And then as a last resort, we'll bring in the military, you know. And they have been masterful at it, as other empires have followed suit, like America as well. But it all began one hazy day many, many years ago in the 1800s, when the Royal Institute of International Affairs in London was formed, and they are the seat of all international bar associations. Bar, meaning British Accreditation Registry, which is a registry of a title of nobility from a British international organization that bestows these titles upon attorneys at law all over the world. And so, whether they're American attorneys or Canadian attorneys, they all get their licensing from the same international agency. But you would think that, and I may be wrong here, but I know it's true in the States, correct me if I'm wrong, but everyone assumes that attorneys are licensed by the state or the government. in the States. They all assume, well, they all say, you can't practice law without a license. All attorneys have to be licensed before they can be in the courtroom. But nobody ever asks, well, who licenses the attorneys? It's supposed to be the Supreme Court of the state, but it turns out that it's the Bar Association licenses the attorneys in the state. Is it the same here or not? I don't know. Could be. Something worth looking at. If the attorneys are to be accountable to the government, then wouldn't they be licensed by the government and regulated by the government? Who regulates the attorneys? Nobody. Nobody. So if you wonder why the legal system is corrupted, because there's no accountability for attorneys in any area of government. That's something to look at. That's a part of legal sovereignty, is understanding how these things are. Because any of you been in court? Enjoy it? Love it? Getting to love it. Okay, good. Anybody go in terrorized, completely like disoriented, don't know what the heck's going on, having a clue what to do here? I plead, not guilty, whatever. We don't understand the rules, the procedures. We're entering into a domain where we have no comprehension of the rules of the game, who the players are, what kind of power is working behind the scenes here, what the outcome will likely mean for us, except probably less money in our pocket. Ka-chink, ka-chink, ka-chink. Ka-chink, ka-chink, ka-chink. Ka-chink, ka-chink, ka-chink. Ka-chink, ka-chink, ka-chink. Open up the cash register and pour it in, folks. It's a revenue-generating private organization that runs the court systems. Private international law. And private international law has supplanted the constitutional laws, the provincial laws, the common laws, all of the laws that the people had domain over at one time. Like we had domain over our own monetary system at one time, we had domain over our own legal systems at one time as well, so we could manage our controversies. But we also kind of lost that. And now private international organizations handle the legal system for us. And they're doing a great job of it, aren't they? We have to understand the nature and the cause of these systems, because until we do, we will be subject to or at the mercy of. And until you claim your own personal sovereignty, until you govern yourself in all these seven aspects, those aspects will be governed by some external authority out there, by default. Not even because they're supposed to or they have to. Why is government so big and getting bigger all the time? Because we're defaulting more and more all the time and our responsibilities as citizens in every country of the world. And thus government grows like a cancer upon the body politic because we're abrogating. I'm not pointing the finger out there, I'm pointing the finger right here. There's more I can do and I do everything that I can. There's more we all can do to restore accountability to all the systems. If indeed you value freedom, and if indeed you value living in a free country where there is still opportunity, and that we're not just all on welfare, basically, you know, while a small little cream of elite people enjoy all of the benefits of everybody's productivity in the world. And I mean, I'm talking about less than 20,000 people control everything in the world, basically. You know, everything that we know of as external systems. I'm not saying they control your minds or your consciousness, not unless you let them. So legal sovereignty, understanding the legal systems and how they work, understanding your citizenship, understanding the difference between natural persons and fictitious persons. And then last but not least, in terms of the seven aspects of sovereignty, is the political aspect of sovereignty. You see how I'm building this? How I build the aspects? I build it from the very personal and the very right here in your body level, and then I build it outward into the economic realm, where we have to be economically empowered to be able to make any difference at all in the world, in some way. And then we have to step into the legal realm of understanding that, not only to protect what we have, and to do the asset protection that's required in these times, because anybody who accumulates any wealth or money is a target by a predator government or a predator agency or some litigation or a lawsuit or something else. Anybody ever experienced that? I heard the groans over here. So people know that that's true when you have, if you have any assets, you have anything to protect. As Bobby McGee said, you know, freedom is just another word for nothing left to lose, right? But of course, my vision of my life and my reality is that I want to create an infrastructure around me and a business infrastructure that I can make a huge difference in the world. and bring these ideas out and educate a lot of people and create news services and resource centers and really have a huge impact. So I have to take steps to protect assets in a very careful and protected way so that I don't come under attack. Or if I do, there's no cake on the table. Tomorrow, we go into asset protection, popular sovereignty, and all the practical nuts and bolts of things. And of course, I appreciate the participation of some of the Canadian resource people there, too, to keep me up to date on some of the things that may be different here than in the US. I don't presume they're the same. They're not. There are some distinctions in terms of what you can and cannot do here by law for asset protection versus the states. But I've become very, very finely tuned to not only in the states, but internationally in foreign jurisdictions and what you can do in banking and investments and money and structures and different companies and entities and foundations and international business corporations and trust and common law and statutory and LLCs and the whole nine yards. So all that gobbledygook that went over most of your heads because you never heard of any of those words before are just legal structures and entities. They're different legal structures. They're different ways of doing business than the ones that you were taught and trained in, which was twofold, for-profit, non-profit. Corporations, both within the jurisdiction, chartered, regulated, and taxed by you know who. So there are other alternatives to be explored and to learn about. And it actually isn't boring. And law is not boring either. You go, oh, law, God, how boring. I'm reading books and stuff like that. It's not boring. I found law to be the most fascinating study of history because law had a documented evidence and reference to the public record that history was always distorted. History always had one side. Whoever won the war got to tell the story. Whoever lost the war didn't get to tell their side of the story. That's history, folks. That's history. That's history. So there's always another side to history, right? So get the other side if you're going to love history. And law was really wonderful because it could fill in some of the blanks, number one. And I found it to be just intriguing. And it's a real key part in terms of understanding what your recourses and remedies are in the legal system, is knowing who you are and who you aren't. Because we aren't what we see when we look in the mirror. A person is a good way of describing this. Person is a legal term. But it's also just used in the general conversation, right? Oh, you're a nice person. Oh, you're a friendly person. Oh, what a wonderful person. Right? We never think about it that well. That using it in that context doesn't work in a courtroom. It doesn't work in a legal argument. Because person has a very specific legal definition for every statute or section of statutes or chapters in different parts. So the Oregon Revised Statutes has 66 unique definitions of persons. So what person are you? I'm not that person, and I'm not that one, and I'm not that one, and I'm not that one. Oh, well, maybe I'm that one, but let me check a little further, you know? So don't assume that just because it says person, that means you. You can't do that in law. If we want nations of the people, by the people, for the people, free countries, once again, we have to build sovereignty up to the level of we the people, once again, taking charge of getting some people in there that understand what we now understand and are willing to protect and defend that and stand behind limited authority in government and not unlimited authority. And I dare say if there's any politicians or future politicians in here, if you're going to get my vote, you're going to have to take the stand of I'm willing to run, but under limited authority that's granted to me by whatever my position and the laws say that I ought to be doing. And not just become a dictator or a tyrant of my own just because now I'm in office and I can do whatever I want at public expense, which tends to be the attitude in government today. You know, and it tends to be our attitude to let them get away with it. And they do. And then they push it further next year, and the year after, and the year after, until before you know it, 100 years have gone by, and you aren't living in the same country anymore. So don't wonder why, or don't wonder what happened. But you can make something different happen. Political sovereignty will be then restored and new nations or old nations will be reformed once we have claimed the other six aspects of sovereignty. Now I know some people approach it from different viewpoints. We have a lot of activists out there that are working on political issues. But unless they actually understand the nature of power, money, love, sovereignty, these different things, I must say that most of what they do in activism is rendered ineffective. It doesn't really work. It doesn't change the core, the foundation of the power structure at all. We want to be effective in what we do. And taboo of power, addressing that, if you look at power structures in the world today, what are they? What's this global elite? What's this, some conspiracy theory? What is it, some kind of nutcase? What's this David Icke look-alike clone or something? Johnny Liberty? What is this guy? What is he talking about up here? If you study history and if you study the law and if you have your eyes awake and you're not totally programmed by the media and believe everything that you see and you do some of your own research, you'll find that pretty consistently through history there have been the same cast of characters that have been handing down the reins of power to new generations of people who have been handing it down to new generations of people who are still holding the reins. And they've created a pretty intricate network of international organizations and central banks and United Nations and other types of nations and arrangements whereby they pretty well hold the strings on most everything that we do or don't do, the choices that we're given. From that viewpoint, power primarily maintains power, not because there are more of them than us, quite the contrary. There's very few of them compared to 7 billion people. As I said, I would assert there's about 22,000 people that hold the key positions of power in the world. In the United States alone, if you map out the boards of directors of the top Fortune 100 companies in the United States of America, there's 250 directors sit on all of those boards. 250 of the same people control the top 100 companies in America. 250 people! If you look at Washington, D.C., and actually get down to the core of who's running things right now in the Bush administration, it's 25 people. The neoconservatives are running the show in Washington right now. You know, then you've got all the shadow governments running around, CIAs and British intelligence and whatever it's called up here. I'm sure you've got some shadow government running up here, too. CSIS. CSIS? Yeah. Moses. The FBI is up here too? Well, the FBI, you know, it's in 162 countries now. They don't have any authority to be anywhere except in the United States, so I don't know who granted them the visas, but they don't belong here. They must have something else in mind because it's Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI. It was never even lawfully created by Congress. The FBI is a branch of the Department of Justice. It wasn't even created by Congress. It was created by the Department of Justice, which is a cabinet position. And it's the police arm of the Department of Justice. The Department of Justice, and I'm going to give you this little story because I think you have a parallel here. Almost everything that you believe about where power is, it ain't there. It's somewhere else. You saw The Wizard of Oz, right? And the man behind the curtain who was kind of pulling the strings and all that stuff. But you thought it was the big icon. I am Oz, the big wizard. I am George Bush, the president of the biggest country in the world. And I'm, you know, you get all these people projected at you and they become the icons of power. But who's the man pulling their strings in the little room, in the back room behind that? Is the taboo question that we never ask. I don't know if we're too scared to ask it or whether we just don't know who's pulling. Who's pulling the strings there? We have names for agencies. Department of Justice. That gives me a really good feeling inside. It makes me feel like, wow, our government cares about justice. They're there protecting my rights and property. Better name the Department of Injustice, I would say, because they're basically violating every civil liberty and every right and every possible form of justice that we have in America today through John Ashcroft and his cronies. Department of Treasury. The Internal Revenue Service, does it even send shudders of fear through Canadian citizens, the IRS? It does? They're not even over here. But still, we react. You see, the fear goes deep, right?
Ours don't carry guns and badges.
Yours don't have guns and badges? Ours do. But they have no authority. That's the only problem with the IRS. Is one, it's not part of our government. Never has been. It's an independent private agency out of Puerto Rico for the collection agency for the Federal Reserve System. And yet they have fraudulently pulled off for almost 100 years And most people believe it's part of the government, da-da-da-da, 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 and that they are a person required to file, pay, and report income taxes. It's just not so. So right now in America, you'll be happy to know, this is news headlines, there are between 80 and 100 million non-filers no longer file taxes in the United States. There's a full-bore tax rebellion going on in the United States. We refuse to pay taxes and support our government. 80 to 100 million no longer file and pay taxes in America. So if you wonder why they've opened up our borders to immigration, it's because they need more taxpayers. Good, loyal taxpayers who can't even speak the language. So if you wonder why that's a whole big thing down there in the States, not because we hate illegal immigrants and the whole business, because we're being, Americans are being distilled out of existence, basically. But I don't do banking in the United States. I don't do business in the United States. I'm an international business corporation, chief executive office of a Panamanian corporation, just like Costco, is a Panamanian corporation. And I have an international foundation, which I use also. Instead of using nonprofits, you can use private interest foundations out of foreign countries. You can still give tax-deductible donations. I don't know about here, but in the United States you can. You don't have to be a nonprofit, 501c3, government-chartered nonprofit corporation to receive monies. Never have. And, I mean, there's just alternatives, is all I'm trying to get to. I'm not going into asset protection tonight. I'm going into all the details of all this stuff. I'm just tickling your fancy, inspiring your minds that are now wide blown open to new possibilities for your life. Not for me, for you. And so, that's the piece on sovereignty. We've interspersed in that a piece on money. We've interspersed a piece on power. Now I want to talk about love. Love is taboo. And love is the medium in which we exist. Quantum physicists probably have a clearer definition of love than most of the romantics throughout history. In that the space that we occupy, we seem to occupy, is so infinitely dense with energy, with aliveness, with intelligence and sentience, that matter is almost insignificant by comparison. It is an awesome contemplation to imagine that space is not empty. Because we were all trained that space is empty, it's void, it's empty, there ain't nothing there. And I think we've also had similar things about love. I mean, we have these things going on with love. I mean, we've been almost pushing love away. It's almost like we think love is void, too. Like there's nothing there, or it's too much hardship and pain, and da-da-da-da-da. You know, I'll just live alone in my alienated, poor, lonely existence. It's kind of like being in space, lost in space, lost in the void of space. But if for one moment you could grasp this notion that space is not empty, that it is so dense and so full that physicists have actually measured the amount of energy in space. And space, I mean space here, I mean space out there, I mean space in here. 99.9% of the human body is space. In between the atoms, every atom, every molecule, every cell of our body, every atom, 99.99% space between the nucleus and the electron. The most dense matter that we know is the nucleus and the black hole. The electron is vaporous against the background of the atom. We are almost all empty, full space. Niels Bohr, who founded the theory of the atom, who discovered the atom, said, this is the atom. We're going to name it. It has neutrons, protons, electrons. When he was asked, how is it that the atom doesn't collapse? He said, I don't know. I decree that it doesn't collapse. And we've been living with that theory ever since. And because you would think if the atom is always energizing, there's always energy moving out of it, emanating, radiating into space, that eventually it would run down, wouldn't it? It'd run out of steam, wouldn't it? Where's the energy coming from? How does the atom sustain its stability? And atoms are relatively stable throughout the whole universe, visible. Billions of light years away, they can examine through spectroscope atomic materials, and they're just like the ones here. Well, if you believe space is empty, you can't really support any theories about that. But if you know that space is full of energy, then where would you suppose the atom might be just getting some of its energy from? Not just some of its energy, but really all the energy that it needs to sustain its structure. And where would then you suppose that you're actually getting all of your energy to support your structure or your body or your cells and your DNA structures? Where are you getting the majority of your energy? By eating, drinking, or breathing? Directly through the plenum, directly through the medium in which we exist, the water that we are blind to, which a fish would be blind to, and the air that a bird is blind to. We are blind to ourselves. We are blind to the love. We are blind to the medium. We are blind to the space. We are blind to the plenum of which we exist, arising out of and collapsing back into. Call it birth and death. It's such a radical shift of perception that you might find some resistance in your mind to even contemplating it, let alone actually experiencing it. And I would suggest if you actually have the courage to experience what it is like to feel, once you've reclaimed your emotional sovereignty and you can feel again, start feeling into the plenum and into the very nature of your own existence. And you might have some interesting discoveries of how connected you really are, and that we really are, and that we are right now in this room, and that the truth is, why is love taboo? And why is maybe this theory a little bit radical in the eyes of modern science, and they don't want to really admit it, is because if we were to admit the degree of our connectedness, all of our barriers and our boundaries would come falling down, wouldn't they? And all those viewpoints of which we so claim the individual identities, and we so claim our national identities, and we so claim our righteousness and our arrogance, and everything else would come falling down with it. And then we might actually just have to be here with each other and actually listen to each other and honor and respect each other in a very, very new way. So I say this is the grand revelation of our time. We are stepping into the possibility in our lifetime, within the next 9 or 10 years even, possibly, of a complete, total, global transformation of consciousness from one of being disconnected, scarcity-modeled, fossil fuel-based, control systems, and brute violence into a completely new paradigm world. And I would say that, in my view, that the crises that we seem to be in on the planet today, which seems to be a crisis, it seems like everything's falling apart. Anything stable that you can see? Everything is just collapsing around us, it seems, and we're struggling to keep things together, right? We're fighting almost tooth and nail to try to hold on to what we have. And our old viewpoints and our old ways of looking at things and that. And I say that maybe the flow is quite the contrary. Maybe we have to let things collapse for new things to be born from it. And take that into your thinking, take that into the contemplation of the plenum. That in 1 cubic centimeter of space, there is a number so large, 10 to the 93 power, ergs of energy, that's inherent in that 1 cubic centimeter space, about the size of my fingernail, which is a number which is so large that if you counted all of the atoms in the visible universe of billions and billions of galaxies, you would have a number smaller than that. In my contemplation of the plenum, that's the sentience, the God, the source, the spirit, the love, all of that is what we are swimming in and are blind to. And when we wake up to that, And we can start waking up to that. And this is what I want to bring out into the world. This is why we're working on the films. That's why we're doing things with conscious people and groups and organizations. Why we want to network globally. Why we want resource centers. Why we want this out there is because it will help fuel and stimulate and inspire a global transformation, a real true revolution without bloodshed, one of consciousness this time. And that's the place where we are, I believe, in our human growth. I know some people don't believe in evolution and all that, so forget the word, just growth and development then. That's where we're at. We're right at a turning point. Each one of us individually is at a turning point, and we're all connected in this turning point. We're not disconnected, we're connected. And when one gets it, and the other awakens and they get it, and the other awakens and they get it, and the other awakens and they get it, we're gonna see a new world overnight, like that fast. It's not gonna take 1,000,000 years. It may not even take 9 or 10 years. And a lot of things are moving towards that 2012 year of total synthesis and integration of a completely new paradigm. And we have to go through the birth pains first. You know, anybody who's a mother, and I'm not, so I can't attest to it. Mothers in the room have had children, had birth. You gotta go through the birth pains. Baby just doesn't come out without through the birth pains, right? I mean, I suppose you can cheat your way there. But, you know, in truth, you gotta birth the baby. Can't stay in there, gotta come out. And I think it's the same true for all of us. You know, we all got some baby inside of us. We all got something we're birthing. We all came here for a purpose. And we came here to birth that purpose, not just individually, but collectively as well, together. And this is the medium in which we are to emerge. So the love is the hopeful note. It's a strong, compassionate, in my view, the very medium in which we exist, in which now they theorize there was no Big Bang Theory. Never existed. Didn't happen billions of years ago and all blah, blah, blah. That the universe is being created right now and always has been created right now. And it only exists because we evoke it through our own participation and perception. You've heard the old phrase, if the tree falls in the forest and there's nobody around, did the tree fall or can you hear it, right? And now from a quantum physics level, they've come to the conclusion that reality is not out there. That reality is, well, not just a whole bunch of brain chemistry coming to a lot of interpretations and conclusions and projecting that reality out there, but also that this plenum is evoking that reality through us. And we have exactly the world that collectively we believe that we're creating. And if we want to shift our beliefs about it, we can create something different. And that a new world will arise because we expect a new world to arise. And we believe and we put our energy and our focus and our attention on a new world arising. And thus we're not victims of reality either. There is no world, I'm sorry to say. There is no world. There's just an evocation of an interpretation of a world through my viewpoint. And if I shift that, the world shifts. Oh, I'm not a passive participant any longer. I really have to be completely and totally responsible for my thoughts, my words, and my deeds, don't I? There's no cop-out anymore. I can't hide, escape, run off, you know, go somewhere where the earth changes won't affect me, you know. There's nowhere to run. There's nowhere to hide. There's nowhere you can go. So stay where you're at. Or shift it, whatever you do. Can you see why this is so taboo? And why we're discussing it tonight? And that I've had this opportunity tonight to share this with you is just so endearing to me because this is my life's work. You give me power, you give me energy, you give me the inspiration because we are doing an energy exchange here. I really am connecting in with each one of you here. I'm seeing you, I'm looking, I'm feeling you. I've reclaimed my sovereignty. I'm not saying I'm perfect, but I've reclaimed my sovereignty. I've taken responsibility for all those seven aspects I take care of my health, my emotional health. I deal with my fears. I've had great opportunities to deal with fear. I've had great opportunities to deal with mental, getting clear, you know, what is really going on. You know, having my own direct personal relationship with spirit, with what I see it to be, with God, my own personal relationship. I've handled my economic sovereignty. I've set up my structures, my businesses, my banking. I'm doing it as independently as anyone can. I'm doing it without paying taxes. I'm doing it without regulations, imposing things that aren't relevant to what I'm doing. I've taken the barriers away from what I want to do. I've looked at the legal sovereignty. I've reclaimed my American citizenship. I've given up my Social Security numbers. I haven't had a state-issued driver's license in 12 years. I haven't had one thing from the government come my way in 12 years. I've set myself up to be able to be sovereign in relation to the government and the state. It doesn't really mean I don't pay taxes, because the truth is there's about 600 different types of taxes. You just don't pay income tax on things where you're in a jurisdiction where you have no income, whereby you're not required to file a payment report in that jurisdiction. But I still pay gas tax and sales tax and excise taxes of all kinds. Still pay communications taxes and sales taxes and cellular phone taxes and, you know, all the other 600 forms of taxes that there are out there. So the idea that I don't pay my fair share is nonsense. Not only do I pay my fair share, I pay a lot more than my fair share, because I give everything that I have into what I believe I want to create in the world. So I tax myself 100% in my reality. I just don't let other people be the channel for my energy, and I go send them 66% of my annual productivity so that they can mess things up for me. if you get the gist, right, of why is it such a bad idea to abolish the income tax? Who needs it? Keep the money home. Keep it close to home. Put it in your pocket. Form it in your local communities. Take care of your communities. That's the way it used to be. You don't need large centralized governments. They don't take care of you anyway. We know the game, right? That's so they can just power over. They can buy their Cadillacs and their boats and do it at public expense. They're not really helping. So I've advocated the abolition of the income tax in America. It doesn't make me a popular figure. You know, I'm not popular.
He doesn't pay his fair share. What would happen if we didn't have a large central government taking care of everybody? How would I take care of myself?
Reclaim your sovereignty. Be sovereign. Take your life back. There is a solution. The best thing we could do for the economy was to eliminate the income tax. Automatically give a raise to every household in America of 40% every year. Anybody get a 40% raise in a year here? Give yourself, you know, I'm talking about the states. I know your taxation's higher here. But 30-40% is only the income tax. If we accumulate all of our taxes together in the states, it's 66%. 66% of our annual incomes are taxed in one form or another by one branch of government or another. And I would say that you probably pay more than that cumulatively here in Canada, leaving you a net to do what as you wish, 10, 20% maybe of your annual income? Something like that? Am I in the ballpark? Yeah. Okay. So just imagine if you reorganize things a little bit differently. It might not be a popular idea here either to abolish the income tax. And all of the benefits you get, including national insurance of health care and all these different things. But that's not the only way to organize healthcare. There are other ways of doing it. And quite frankly, the insurance-based systems don't work good because they don't provide you healthcare. Because you don't get to choose. The insurance company decides your treatment, not the doctor. Am I correct? They decide what the disease is, they label it, and they treat you with whatever drug they'll pay for. So you don't get healthcare for the money you pay for it. What you get is drugs and pharmaceuticals and other life-damaging substances in your body. It's actually destructive. And so the clinic that I just went to, I checked a friend in who's had chronic illness for 38 years, is finding herself healthier in the first week of treatment than she has in 38 years of her life, because they're addressing the root of the diseases that cause the symptoms, the conditions that cause it, in the most comprehensive and holistic fashion I've ever experienced. And so there are alternatives to that. But in all of this, we've explored the taboos, we've looked at sovereignty, we've given it an introduction through the seven aspects of sovereignty. We've addressed money, not to great depth, but re-examine it, look at it, and let's not be addicted to it. Don't be at the effect of money in your life. Let money be a tool in your toolkit that you can apply to the things you want to create in life. Generate as much as you want or as little as you need. And remember to leave enough time every day to languish, lay around, and do absolutely nothing. Because a measure of happiness has everything to do with how much time, and a measure of health, by the way, has a measure of how much time you give yourself every day to just sit around and do absolutely nothing. Without, you know, your to-do list. God, the to-do list. I never get my to-do list done. And it's always more to do, to do, to do. So tonight, and when you leave here, everybody starts a to-be list, and you put nothing on it. Nothing. There's nothing on the list, but make the list anyway. To be, nothing on it. Okay, so put it side by side with your to-do list. And kind of balance the two in your time management system. And you'll get immediate health results and immediate de-stress and relaxation and other things. So we've looked at love. We've talked about it in a somewhat abstract way, but I think all the religions and all the spiritual paths have also talked about love, that really love is the foundation of all religion and of all spirituality. And as I've said, if your religion doesn't teach you to love your brother or love your sister or to love each other, and the golden rule is not your foundational principle, then I don't think your religion is going to do you any good, quite frankly. But that's up to everybody to decide for themselves and not to judge and certainly not to generalize. And I know it's real easy when things are polarized in the media to just simply judge and just blanket go out and just, you know, Islam is evil. You know, it's real easy to just come up with that conclusion and that anybody who's a Muslim is evil. It's real easy to do that in a polarized mind. But it takes a brave intelligence to be able to see the value in everything. F. Scott Fitzgerald said it in a famous quote, which I like to use to define intelligence. The test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposing ideas in the mind at the same time. Because it creates a dynamic of discovery of what is real and what is true. If you adopt only one side of the coin, or one side of an equation, or one side of the story, or one side of a dichotomy or a polarization, at best, you have half the story. If you got that right. So let's consider both sides of the story. And when, just like in an atom, you've got two sides of the same coin in polarization together, in a dynamic with each other, there's a tension there. There's a natural tension. But that's where intelligence has the capacity to work. Only when both sides are working in a dynamic together. Not when one's been eliminated. So all you got to look at is that. That's called indoctrination. That's called mind control. That's called programming. That's called public education. That's called the evening news. That's called the daily newspaper. That's called whatever political party you happen to be supporting. That's called, you know, you see how indoctrinated we are into that way of thinking, though. That's not healthy for the human race. And it will never bring about a new paradigm. This is how the new paradigm is created, by bringing that two sides of the coin together in wrapped around our personal sovereignty. Take your intelligence within the foundations of sovereignty and hold that tension and start walking your life that way and start living your life that way. And you'll see that life changes, reality changes, and opportunities show up anywhere when you start networking with each other. And when you really start connecting, back full circle again to the art of networking, when you start learning the art of connecting with each other instead of the art of disconnecting from each other or the art of polarizing each other and the art of dividing each other as the power structure does to us, and they do it to us because we've let them, but power maintains power primarily because the people are divided and the people are unaware of how divided they are, and they're not willing to connect, and therefore power by default rules. That's how power structures became what they are, and that's how power structures fall. How did Gandhi unite a nation? With war and guns and bum and bum and bum? No. With the simplest, smallest grain of salt. He had a point of connection that united a nation and ultimately threw the British out. So ask yourself as a nation, as a person, as an individual, what is your grain of salt? What is my grain of salt? What is the unifying principle in any group, organization, or business, or network, or anything that you're doing that can bring people to connect to each other? And that's where you're going to get power. And develop that power, because so many of us have been unfamiliar with power in the domains we don't even want to acknowledge we have it. We don't know how to act when we get it. And you see people around you in your who have never had power, and then they get it, they turn into monsters sometimes. They get a little money and they get arrogant. Get a little money and now I can buy the world, right? You watch people change because we haven't had a lot of experience with owning our own power. But when you own your own power, you don't have to abuse the money you have. You can do good with it. You don't have to abuse power over other people any longer when you know you have power over yourself. People who want power over other people are insecure. They don't believe they have any power. They can't control anything. They're insecure. They're not enough. And so they got to control the whole world so they can feel okay. Isn't that weird? Isn't that the way it is? I mean, I don't see our leaders as very secure, balanced, integrated individuals. I don't see them as healthy or happy. I don't see billionaires being very happy running around. I see them very insecure, you know, and all that. I don't see people who have stuff. So why would I want what they have? I mean, look what they got. I don't want that. I want what I have. I want what I can create. I don't want them or what they have. But get practiced in using your own power and start small, you know? Start with your domain. Start with your life. And then extend that power in a helpful way, and in a way of service to people around you. Start with your families, your kids, your neighbors, your friends, your relatives. Christmas, Thanksgiving, remember. And then your communities around you, and then your provinces, and then your nations. That's how we will restore sovereignty to the people and bring about a new paradigm world. I would just simply call it another world order. Another one. Not one world order. Nah, humbug. Not one world odor, either. Kind of smells. I don't like that smell of that one world order stuff. So how about another world order? That's what I see. So with that, I'm going to close, and then we can open up for questions and dialogue, take a break, get some water. We got another half hour or so we can play and talk. Just for your information, there are CDs on all kinds of subjects over there. There's catalogs. Please take one of each page of the catalog with you. There's a whole host of books and products that we offer, and we offer them for different educational reasons. So we have sovereignty books, we have prosperity books, we have books on money, we have books on international structuring and private foundations and law. There's different projects and businesses that we work on developing, such as media companies and that. There's solar energy technologies. There's a whole host of things. So just like that Whole Earth Catalog I mentioned earlier, is that ICR is the electronic Whole Earth Catalog of the new paradigm emerging, of which we are going to broadcast 24 hours a day a full-bore audio-video news service to the world free, so that anybody can pick up the signals of all the good news things going on in the world, so that we can shift this paradigm as quickly as possible.